And our format is always the same. Welcome, song, prayer, sharing, and comments are welcome, and closing. We're going to listen to a song together, and it's called, well, you'll see. Will you type done when you're finished, please?
Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. The solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. His oath is covenant, his blood, support me in the whelming flood. All around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground sinking sand. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand. Oh, thank you, Lord. Solid rock.
All are so funny. I like the song, On Christ the Solid Rock We Stand, All Other Ground is Sinking Sand. But when you go to Jesus' teaching and that little kid's song about the wise man built his house upon the rock, and you look at the area where Jesus was probably doing that teaching, and you see the wadi, and you see the cliffs and the rock cliffs, and the sand would be so much easier to build on near the water and everything. But once or twice a year, it floods and it comes from the mountains, and it's a flash flood, and it washes away everything, anything that is outside of the blood of Jesus that we build our life upon is sifting sand, and it will not stand. But everything that we build our life upon, which is Jesus and his sacrifice for our redemption, is solid rock, and nothing on heaven, on earth, on under the earth, or above the earth can take that away from us, because everything else is sifting sand, but Jesus is the rock. And that is our hope. So that was a little bonus. I like the song. Let's pray. You know, like Hebrew culture facts too. Father, we just come to you tonight or today, whatever time it is for us. And we invite you to move among us. We invite you to send your spirit, to draw your spirit from us, to touch, to heal us, to restore us. Father, I ask that each one of us would see Jesus, just as those disciples did when they thought all was lost. It was over. There was no hope. And then there he comes, walking down the road, appearing in the building, in the midst of them. So, Father, we thank you that you are here in the midst of us, because you say wherever two or three are gathered in your name, you are there. So we know you're there, and we know that you indwell each of us. So, Father, have your way in this time, and help us, Lord, to set aside all the cares of this day, even the past 5 minutes or the past year, and simply be with you and your word in this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. We have been looking, we started last Monday, which was the Monday after Resurrection Day. We have been looking at Jesus' appearances after his resurrection. And so far we talked about his appearing to the women. And in that culture, women were disdained. They were kind of disdained. And so it's neat how Jesus chose to affirm them and visited them first. And plus, women have no credibility. Their word does not stand up in a court of law back then. And who does he come to? Women. And what does he tell them to do? Go and tell. He comes to us and he tells us, men and women, to go and tell. That's part of the Great Commission, to go. We receive freely and freely we give. We go. We tell of what Jesus has done for us. So after we talked about the women last week, then we talked about Jesus' appearance, how he appears to Cleopas and his friend. And that was on the road to Emmaus and some other people too then. And then they went and reported to the 11 apostles. And Luke 24:33-35 says, and they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. And we're going to pick up here. And it's hard to go through and get the exact chronological order, because the Gospels tell it a little differently, but that proves it's true. So we're going to pick up here, where he appears to 10 apostles. It's in Mark 16:14. And it says, afterward, he appeared to the 11 themselves as they were reclining at table, and he rebuked them for their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they had not believed those who saw him after he had risen. And notice that that's all Mark says. That's it. He gives very little detail, but he gives that detail that I don't believe anybody else does. And in Luke, the same event, 36-43, we're going to read that. We're using ESV. And in Luke 24:36-43, It says, as they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace to you. And do you notice the greeting? Peace to you. It's very similar to what angels often said. Yes, shalom. Some people nowadays seek after angelic encounters, and they think that's going to be some warm, fuzzy thing. But most of the times that I can think of in the Bible, when an angel appeared, the human was terrified. And imagine you were those 11, and you're hiding out, kind of. And you see not an angel, but you see the risen Christ. I can indeed see why he spoke peace to them. And maybe also he was offering them peace after what they'd gone through. And we don't know that. But we do see in the next portion their reaction to seeing Jesus in the flesh. Because remember, they thought he was dead. And even though they'd been told, they didn't believe. And verse 37 says, he says, peace to you. And they were startled and frightened, and they thought they saw a spirit. Imagine a spirit or a ghost, they thought. But Jesus was kind, and he was understanding at this point and in all these other gospels. And this is what he said. Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your heart? He knows, doesn't he? See my hands and my feet? Touch me and see, for a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Do you know that the wounds in his hand and his feet were for you personally, as well as each one of them? And Dodie, no. Do you recognize the kindness, the care, and the compassion that Jesus is showing to these men he loved? And then that portion continues in verse 41 through 43. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, have you anything here to eat? And they gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it, and he ate it before them. And again, the same event is in John chapter 20, verses 19 through 25. And notice how some things are exactly the same, and sometimes the author tells a different perspective. Verse 19, on the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. And I want you to notice something, this is a Dodie note. Next, he's going to give them instructions, which are instructions for each of us to follow once we have had an encounter with the risen Lord at new birth. And that's when we first encounter him. Verse 21. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And then the next verse, it makes me wonder, but I do not know. I wish I did know, and I don't know, and I don't know how to find out. So I wonder if the next verse is the first impartation of the indwelling of Holy Spirit, because I don't know. But this is what he said. He says to them, peace, as the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And then, according to this author, of the gospel. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld. Is it Coram Deo? Is it, can you type, is it the first time? The permanent indwelling? I know in the Old Testament, they received, what they needed for a time, but it wasn't permanent. I know I never really noticed it. Maybe he, too bad he doesn't. He's cooking dinner. And the Dodie note. This is all still from the same passage in John 20, I believe. Thomas was not there, and like everyone else, he needed to see for himself. So the next appearance will be to Thomas. And again, we are noticing the intricate detail with which Jesus meets the needs of each of his beloved. And I believe with all my heart that Jesus wants to meet each of our needs because we are his beloved in the same intricate manner, which might not look the same for you as it would for me. So this is continuing in John 20. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. And so, the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see his hands and the mark of the nails and place my finger into the mark of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. And this is a note from the author, and I forgot to bring the reference, but here's what he said. Either while Cleopas and his friend were still there or afterward, the 11 apostles are discussing this claim during the evening of the same Easter day, the first day of the week. They had the doors locked, fearful that the Jews might plot against them and arrest them. And that was a valid fear. And then, this is a retelling by this author. Jesus appears to the 10 apostles and Thomas is absent, but they presume he is a ghost. And he encourages them to look at his hands, his feet, and his side. And he even insists that they touch him. But this still does not completely convince, according to this author, the apostles that he's really risen. Because it said that in the scripture up there. He eats with them, and then the reality of the resurrection registers with them. And they are overjoyed. And I guess because a ghost or a spirit could not eat food. And then, according to the timelines that I could find, a week later on a Sunday, Jesus appears to them again with Thomas present. And doubting Thomas, they call him, becomes convinced. And isn't it neat that Jesus did this just to meet Thomas's need? And this is what it says in chapter 20 of John. The same passage, same gospel. 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, peace be with you. Same greeting. Always the same. Shalom. Peace be with you. And verse 27. Then he said to Thomas, put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. And Thomas, and this is a very interesting response from Jesus. Thomas answered him, my Lord and my God. And Jesus said to him, have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. Yes, that's what that guy said to Jesus. And you know what? Blessed are we, everyone in here, who has not literally seen and yet have believed. Hi, Luana. Welcome. And the next one is absolutely my favorite. I forgot to spell check. The next one is my favorite appearance. I just love this one. About 2 weeks later, according to what I could figure out from the timelines and the references, so this would be 3 weeks, Jesus appeared to the disciples while they were fishing, and he eats with them. Jesus gives Peter a chance to undo his three denials by three affirmations of his love for Jesus. I love this so much. Peter, remember on the night he was betrayed, right after he said he would never, Lord, I will never deny you. And then he did three times, just like Jesus said before the rooster crowed. And then imagine when Peter did that, and the scripture says, gives us a good idea, the shame Peter felt when he realized what he had done. But Jesus, loving Peter, fixes it for him and fully restores Peter. There is no rejection, only restoration. So a take-home point, a personal point, when we sin, we too find restoration and forgiveness. And I don't think that's cheap grace, because my next comment is, it's, well, when we admit our sin and have godly sorrow and repentance. Because there are times, and we've all known people, maybe even ourselves, when people sin, they get caught, and they're really sorry. Little kids are really good about that. But they're not sorry for hurting another person. They're not sorry for doing wrong, or we're not, but they're sorry for being found out. Or even having consequences. That is not godly sorrow. That sort does not lead to restoration. Godly sorrow is vastly different. And instead of hiding or covering up, we freely own or admit our wrong, and we go to God for forgiveness. So instead of running away from God, we run to God. Now let's read John 21. This encounter. This is verse 1. After this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. And Simon Peter said to them, I'm going fishing. And they said to him, well, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. And just as day was breaking, Jesus stood on the shore. Yet the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Isn't it amazing how often they don't recognize him? This is the third time, at least, that they've seen him. They have seen him before, and they do not recognize him. I wonder if sometimes God's at work in our life, and we don't recognize him. Verse 5 and 6. Jesus said to them, children, do you have any fish? And they answered him, no. And he said to them, cast the net on the right side of the boat and you will find some. So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. And then you gotta love how John describes himself in his Gospels. That disciple whom Jesus loved, therefore, said to Peter, it is the Lord. And when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and he threw himself into the sea. And the other disciples came in the boat, dragging that net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. And when they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with the fish laid on it and bread. And here's a Doty note. I think he just went. Jesus is providing for them. He's providing a meal for them. They've got to be hungry. They've been out fishing all night. They got nothing. And then he provides a net full of fish, which will get them money. But he also has cooked breakfast for them. And I think he might be reminding them of another time when he did a miracle with fish. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of those disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. In verse 13 and 14, Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. And now for my favorite part. You guys know what it is, don't you? Jesus and Peter. Now, when they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And Jesus, he said to him, "Feed my lambs." And then he, meaning Jesus, said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And he said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." And so Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." So feed my lambs, tend my sheep. Verse 17. He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." And so Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." Now, Doty note. Three denials, three affirmations. Each word for love is slightly different. According to one commentator, and I don't read Greek or Hebrew, so Jesus used the Greek word agape for love the first two times, while Peter used a different word, philia. Agape carries the meaning of intense, complete, devoted, sacrificial love, while philia refers to love as in friendship. So Peter was essentially saying, "Well, Lord, all I commit to right now is that I like you like a friend." In other words, he's according to this author and according to the word used when Peter responds, it's brotherly love. Not, "I will serve you, you are the Lord. I will give all for you" love. And God Questions affirms this and says this. This is a great teaching. If anybody ever would do it in depth for us, it would be great. It seems that Jesus is trying to get Peter to understand that he must love Jesus unconditionally in order to be the leader that God is calling him to be. And the third time Jesus asks, "Do you love me?" in John 21:17, Jesus changes his word to philia. And Peter again responds with, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Again, using philia, brother love. The point in the different Greek words for love seems to be that Jesus was stretching Peter to move him from philia love to agape love. And that makes total sense. Whatever the reason, Yes, he did. He did. Yes, to feed the sheep. It's like Jesus comes down to the... He can't lift him up, so he comes down to his level. Okay. You know? Whatever the reason for the threefold do you love me question, Jesus was impressing on Peter how important his new role of tending the flock of Christ's followers would be. When someone repeats instructions to us over and over, we quickly understand that it's extremely important for us to heed them. Jesus wanted to make sure that Peter understood this vital charge he was tasking him with and the ultimate reason for it, to follow him and glorify God. And this is a Doty note. I think it's really neat that Jesus asked three times. It's also neat that loving Jesus is an action which requires caring for others. Three times. Feed my lambs, tend my sheep, feed my sheep. And continuing back to our passage in the Gospel of John, chapter 21. This is interesting too. Truly, truly, I say to you, when you were young, this is to Peter still, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you do not want to go. This he said to show him by what kind of death he was going to glorify God. And after saying this, he said to him, follow me. In verse 20, Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved following them, the one who also had leaned back against him during supper and had said, Lord, who is it that is going to betray you? And when Peter saw him, when Peter saw John, now Peter's been told, Peter's been just affirmed his love for God, for Jesus three times. He's been restored. But he's also been told how he's going to die. And then look what he does. So human. He sees that when it says Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, that's John who wrote this gospel. When Peter saw him, he said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? And Jesus said to him, if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. So the saying spread abroad among the brothers that this disciple was not to die. Yet Jesus did not say to him that he was not to die. But he said, if it is my will that he remain until I come, what is that to you? And this is John who wrote it, verse 24 and 25. This is the disciple who is bearing witness about these things and who has written these things, and we know that his testimony is true. Now, there are also many other things that Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose that the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. Now, here's a funny Doty note. This has just popped into my head while I was studying this. You're going to love it. Did you catch where Jesus basically told the disciple John to mind your own business? Sometimes we are envious of something about a brother or sister in Christ. Maybe someone's gifted by God in a way we wish we were. Perhaps we just need to be grateful and happy to be who God created us to be and do whatever he created or designed us to do. It's a kind of a MYOB, mind your own business, plus gratitude, minus envy. So mind your own business, be grateful to God for who you are and what you have and the plans he has for you, and don't be jealous of other people. Isn't that funny? There are several other, I know, I thought that was really funny. There are several other appearances of Jesus mentioned in Scripture, including his appearance to a large crowd of over 500 individually, to his brother James, Peter, and to Paul. And this is outlined in Corinthians, not in the Gospels. So we're going to read that. Now, I would like to remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, and in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. This is Paul speaking. I think Paul wrote Acts. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and then to the twelve. And then, and this is where we see this, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. And then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles. And last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. And then he appeared one other time, at least, when he gave the Great Commission, which is in Matthew 28, 19 through 20, but actually we're going to pick up in verse 16. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." Teaching them to observe all I have commanded you. And behold, I love this, I am with you always to the end of the age. And then the next thing, the last thing I believe we're going to discuss tonight is the ascension. It's in Luke 24. 50 and 51 in Acts 6:1-6-12. We read of his meeting, which was described in Luke 24 earlier tonight, but we stopped at verse 43. So we're going to pick up at verse 44. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." And then he opened their minds to understand the Scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Christ should suffer and on the third day rise from the dead, and that repentance for the forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem." You are witnesses of these things, and behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with power on high. So it appears from the Scripture that when he breathed the Holy Spirit on them, that was one thing, but the power was the Pentecost thing. they had to wait for that. And they did do that. They did that. They did go there and wait. And sometime later, we see him ascend. In Luke, it appears to occur right after that meeting. And this is what Luke says. And he led them out as far as Bethany. And lifting up his hands, he blessed them. And while he blessed them, he parted from them and was carried up into heaven. Not a lot of detail, is it? We want more. But it's also described in Acts 1, 6 through 11, and so we'll look at that. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were standing there, can you imagine, with their mouths wide open? And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who was taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. And as a matter of fact, Acts 1 through 3 summarizes as follows. After his suffering, he showed himself to these men and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. We read about those. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. And we do not get exact details, but we got some. And Acts 1 verse 12 is a great ending for the night. And then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. And so they went to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. And even to wherever we are, wherever we were, the message went. And the Lord found us. And we recognized him. And so we say, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come afresh to us tonight. Come in the morning. Come as we sleep. Help our eyes to constantly be open, watching for your return, watching for your direction, rejoicing in who you are and that we belong to you. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. And so the story continues till this day. I found that interesting. I couldn't do a perfect job. I'm still not completely satisfied, but I wanted to know, and I wanted to share with you what I found out. So that's what I found out, and that's what we all know collectively now. And Lord bless you. And I think Violinist has a treat for us.